Now we will talk about cervical spondylosis and lumbar spondylosis. Before we talk about cervical and lumbar spondylosis, there are a few prerequisites you must understand so that understanding the spondylosis will be easier for you. Spondylosis is not a disease of the bone or the disc. It involves other areas of the spine as well. So what are common? The common is that disc discates and loses its height. And the disc becomes thinner and it loses its elasticity, and the facet joints become unstable, and you can find osteophytes, which actually can reduce the diameter of spinal canal and foramina, and this will have its own consequences. Now let us look at this diagram. Though this diagram shows the thoracolumbar spine, actually it is what is shown and what discussed is truly applicable also for cervical spine. Now, if you see the top figure, this is a normal disc, and please have a look at this relationship of facet joints. This is a normal facet joint. Now, as you go down, you find that there is a protrusion of disc, and the height of the disc becomes less, and as you move on, the disc itself, the protruded disc itself, can compromise the intervertebral foramina and the spinal canal. And have a look at this relationship between the facet joints. Because of this, you can have facet joint arthropathy, and again you'll have osteophyte formation, and that osteophytes can actually compromise the space in the spinal canal or intervertebral foramina, and but thereby pressing on the nerve roots or the cord itself. Now there are three terms that we need to remember and understand, actually, because whenever you talk about degenerative disease or any conditions of the spine, actually, these terms will be used very frequently, and we need to know what exactly we mean by each of these. Number one is radiculopathy. Radiculopathy is a low motor neuron lesion resulting from nerve root compression, and it is expressed as sensory and motor deficits and diminished or absent reflexes of the involved level. This is because of compression at the spinal nerve. The other is radicular pain. It means radiating pain down the limb as a result of irritation, inflammation of the nerve root. So you can have radicular pain in the upper limbs as well as the lower limbs. The last is myelopathy. It's an upper motor neuron lesion expressing as hyperreflexia below the involved lesion level, and this is because of compression of the cord rather than the spinal nerve. Now let's talk about the clinical features again. Mostly it is asymptomatic, because if you get an X-ray done of a person who is not complaining of C-spine pain, you can, if the patient is old enough, you can find all the features, X-ray features of C-spondylosis, but the patient will be asymptomatic. So mostly it is asymptomatic, but if the patient is symptomatic, what you find is the patient will complain of neck pain, stiffness, and the patient may have features of radiculopathy or myelopathy, and the pain may radiate to occiput, back of shoulder, interscapular area, in one or both limbs. I have seen patients complaining of pain in the scapular region, and doctors getting X-ray of the scapula rather than the neck, actually. So whenever a patient complains of pain in the scapular region, you should not forget to examine the shoulder and the C-spine as well. On examination, you will find a spasm and tenderness of neck muscles, and the neck range of motion will be restricted, and there may be features of radiculopathy or myelopathy. On X-rays, you will find decreased joint space, disc space at one or more levels, and you will find osteophytes along the anterior and posterior margins of the disc. And you will also find, as in the case of osteoarthritis of knee and hip, you will find subchondral sclerosis in the disc and the end plates, superior end plates and disc. Inferior plates, there will be subchondral sclerosis. Now the MRI is actually more sensitive, and it shows the details which are otherwise not seen on X-rays. MRI will tell us about the status of the disc, the foramen, the vertebrae, and the ligament flavum, which is not seen on X-rays. And once you have examined the patient clinically, you want to know these clinical features because of radiculopathy and myopathy. And once you get an MRI, your questions are again answered. Let us have a look at this X-ray. This X-ray shows osteophytes here, the arrow-string osteophytes, and here there's a multiple level involved. Again, the end plates are not regular. There's subchondrous sclerosis everywhere, and the joint and the multiple posterior osteophytes are seen here. Now, these are two MRIs of patients with two different ages. One is 46 years old male, and the other is 80 years old male. Now, if you look at this X-ray MRI, the symptoms or the features on the left side are more severe as compared to that on the right side, though this patient is young, which means that the features that you see on X-ray or MRI has no bearing to the age. Even if you are elderly, you may still have minor features. If you are young, that does not mean that you will not have severe features. The good thing about this MRI is that the MRI tells you about the compression of the cord, which is not seen on X-ray. Now, treatment, again, analgesics are required. Analgesics is number one to relieve the pain, and the other is to prepare the patient for exercises. So, analgesics, hot water fomentation, cervical traction. If you see the figure on the left side, this is what you do in an OPD. If the patient says, yes, when you do this, when you distract my cervical spine, my pain relieves, my gets better, then this means this patient will benefit from cervical traction. Because every other person will not benefit from cervical traction. And by performing this test, you will be able to identify who will benefit from cervical traction and who will not. And the patient could also complain of vomiting and nausea or giddiness rather. And in those cases, prescribing cinnarizine is a good idea. Once the acute pain has subsided, the patient should be put on asymmetric knee exercises, and these are the features of asymmetric knee exercises. In each direction, you will have to press for 10 seconds and 10 cycles. So, posteriorly 10 seconds, laterally, anteriorly, medially, on the left side, on the right side. So, you make a circle, and so every day the patient has to exercise for 10 seconds, exercise, press for 10 seconds on each side, on four sides, that in 10 cycles. If these don't work, then the patient may need surgery, especially if there's a neurological deficit. But before surgery, actually, these are the medicines used for pain because of neuralgia. So gabapentin or pregabalin, amitriptyline, methylcobalamin, duloxetine. Nowadays, it is a good idea to combine one or two medicines, two or three medicines, in fact. So nowadays, most of the medicines are, come in combination. So it's a good idea that you use medicines in combination. Now, if these don't work, then the only option you have is surgery. And you should always give a trial of 3 months of conservative treatment before you advise the patient that now, I think if it is not working, then you should contemplate surgery. The most commonly performed surgery is anterior cervical discectomy infusion, in which you remove the disc in between the involved vertebrae and put a bone graft there, and you may need to place a plate anteriorly, or especially that is done in case of trauma, but just putting the graft itself may suffice. Now we'll talk about lumbar spondylosis. In many ways, it is similar to cervical spondylosis. So the patient will complain of back pain, movements will be restricted, and there may be features of radiculopathy or myelopathy. Here again, the features you'll find osteophytes, subchondrous sclerosis, reduced disc space, and MRI. Again, like cervical spondylosis, the features will be more obvious, and features which are not seen on X-ray may be seen on MRI. It is never enough to prescribe medicines, actually. The patient has to know what he is supposed to do, he is not supposed to do. So this is one example of a list of advice that we have given to the patients. And this actually turns out to be a conservative treatment of back pain also. So bhuima basera kaam nagarne nasochne, that is because the reason why we discourage people from getting lying on the floor is because getting up from a lying position or from ground level is always painful. So there is a technique of getting down from bed to prevent back pain. So that can be done only if the patient is lying on bed, not when the patient is lying on the floor. So the patient should never sit or lie on the floor. And you should also not lie on the low bed, a low sofa, a low, or it could be mudra. So that has to be told the patient. And there is a misconception regarding hard surface, sleeping on hard surface. People think that hard surface would mean something which is really hard. So what they do, they sleep on the bed sheet. So here I will repeat, I will just read what is written out here. Tanna, radi, galancha, adi, kada sotama, no sutne. Because actually these are very uncomfortable and it is not at all useful at all. So the patient should always sleep, you know, in a position which is always comfortable. What is meant by hard bed is, you know, something which does not sag down. So let us say you are using a Dunlop which is, let's say, a 4 inches thick. Then that would mean that the person would sag down. So this is not, that is not advised. But what we are using, cotton mattress, are just as good as anything. Or nowadays you find ready-made mattresses which are very thick but which are do not sag down. So these mattresses can be used. Sikaeko tarikale matra khatbata uthne. If you read this, it will be very clear. Ek patti farkera khutta paila jharera, duvai hatko sahara liye dhadlai napatarike uthne. This is the least painful method of getting up from a bed. So whether you are a patient suffering from any condition which is giving rise to back pain, this is the only method of getting up from bed. And you should try to avoid any kind of jerking kind of movement, because that is going to increase the pain. And if the patient is having very acute pain, then patient is advised to use lumbar corset. But you should not get used to this lumbar corset. Or for that matter, when I was talking about cervical spondylosis, I might have missed. There is something called a cervical collar, soft cervical collar. So whenever there is acute pain, actually, you could use soft cervical collar. Soft cervical collar is soft. It does not prevent movement, but it reminds the patient that he or she should not move his neck too much. So similarly, a patient who is having acute pain, acute low back pain, is advised to use this lumbar corset. It will decrease the lumbar corset is little more rigid. It will decrease the movement at the lumbar spine and thereby also decrease the pain. And the patient should not bend or try to lift weight. And there is a method of sitting. Basnu parda dhadlai support dine kursima dine ra kursima upar khutti lagaera matre basne. These are things actually you could read and you could check YouTube actually. But then, there's one thing actually, you know, a lot of people actually start exercises when they are not advised to do so, and they stop exercises when they are supposed to do. Like a lot of people feel that, you know, exercises are done to relieve pain. Mostly exercises are not done to relieve pain. Exercises are done to strengthen your muscles so that you do not suffer from the same problem again and again. So that is why we have written here, डाक्टर वा फिजियोथेरापिस्टले सिकाएको कसरत मात्र गर्ने र सुरु गर्नु भनेपछि मात्र सुरु गर्ने, बिकज यु सुड नट स्टार्ट एक्सर्साइज वेन यु आर नट सपोज टु डु इट. सो फर ट्रिटमेन्ट देयर आर एनाल्जेसिक्स, हट वाटर फर्मेन्टेसन, लम्बर कोर्सेट एन्ड एक्सर्साइजेस. नाउ एक्सर्साइजेस निड टु बी टेलर मेड, यु निड टु टेलर्ड. सो सम पिपल विल बेनिफिट फ्रम एक्सटेन्सन एक्सर्साइज, सम विल बेनिफिट फ्रम फ्लेक्सन एक्सर्साइज, एन्ड इट इज आवर जब टु find out which exercise will benefit him. So when you examine the patient, you are supposed to examine him in a standing position. You ask him to bend forwards, you ask him to bend backwards. This is active flexion and active extension. Now if the patient complains of pain on active flexion, then most probably the patient will benefit from extension exercises. And similarly, if the patient complains of pain on extension, the patient may benefit from flexion exercises. Which means whatever movement, any movement which gives rise to pain should not be done and exercises should not be performed in the direction of the pain. Our intention is to improve the strengthen the abdominal muscles and back muscles. Whether it is knee osteoarthritis or hip osteoarthritis, whether it is cervical spondylosis or knee lumbar spondylosis, the purpose is to strengthen the muscles so that the joints supported by that particular muscles, the muscles supporting that particular joint becomes strong and supports the joint, thereby decreasing the pain. So for cervical spine as well as lumbar spine, if you improve the, if you strengthen the muscles, all the muscles around the neck that will support the cervical spine, and if you improve, strengthen the abdominal muscles and back muscles, that will strengthen the, that will strengthen the muscles and that will support the lumbar spine. So that is the reason why we prescribe exercises. And that also explains why you should not use orthosis for too prolonged periods, because when you don't use the muscles, that muscles will go into atrophy. On one hand, we are trying to strengthen the muscles, and the other hand, if you don't use it, it will go into atrophy and you'll be defeating the very purpose. So, so to telling the, here you can see a figure, this patient is flexing his hip and knee. Actually, this is passive flexion of the spine actually. So the patient may say, yes, I get, I have relief when I do this, which means this patient should be advised the exercise. And all exercises is very easy to remember, 10 sets of 10 seconds each. So if he is to be advised exercise, then you can start with a little bit of flexion from a little bit of flexion on both hips and knees, and start from left hip, left knee for that matter. So that will be flexed so that the thigh touches the abdomen, hold it for 10 seconds, and then you alternate with the right and do it 10 times. And similarly, you flex both the hips and knees and perform 10 for 10 seconds, 10 times each. If any of the movements relieve pain, then that kind of exercise can be started right away. Otherwise, exercises should be done only after course analgesics has been prescribed. During any exercise, if the patient complains of pain, it means either the patient did not do the exercise properly, number one, either the exercise was prescribed too early, or the wrong exercise was prescribed. So the fundamental thing and the as a concept, no exercise should give rise to pain. No exercise should be done when you have pain, whether for any condition of the body. If the exercise gives rise to pain, it should be discontinued. And whenever there is pain, it should not be done. Only once in a while, passive exercises can relieve pain. In that case, that can be done. Otherwise, active exercises are not advised in acute pain. So, as we said, what is important is strengthening the abdominal muscles and back muscles. Now, how it's done is not important, but we must understand that the purpose of the exercise is to strengthen. So the first diagram, this shows that this is exercise to strengthen the abdominal muscles. This also shows strengthening the abdominal muscles. This exercise actually is done to strengthen the back muscles, and this figure in this kind of exercise actually you strengthen both the back muscles and as well as the abdominal muscles. Now, if nothing works, then you are left with nothing other than surgery. But in lumbar spine, actually, the surgery what is done is depends on what is the predominant feature. For example, if the predominant feature is prolapse in the vertebral disc, then you would want to do discectomy. If there's a spinal stenosis, the predominant feature, then you would want to do a surgery which is going to increase the canal diameter of the canal, spinal canal. And if it is spondylolisthesis, especially when after getting an X-ray of the lateral view, you find in complete flexion and complete extension, you find that there is movement in between the adjoining vertebrae, which means the spondylolisthesis is not stable, then that would call for arthrodesis of that vertebra, of that two levels. And depending on whether the patient has radiculopathy or myelopathy, the surgery will vary. Thank you very much.